We rise and turn and face the cross as we sing our opening hymn, 366, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. Continue now with our invocation and our confession and absolution. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Brothers and sisters, although God abides in us and His love is perfect in us, we sin every day and need the assurance of His forgiveness. Let us go to God, seeking His power to amend our sinful lives. Lord Jesus, the love of God made manifest among us. There is good news for you. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for you, and for His sake He forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And you may be seated for a hymn of praise. On Christmas night, all Christians sing 377.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you make us glad with the yearly remembrance of the birth of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that we through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for our readings. The Old Testament reading for the Nativity of our Lord is from Isaiah chapter 9. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult, and every garment rolled in blood, will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord. We sing hymn 393, Infant Holy, Infant Lowly. Epistles from Titus chapter 2. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. This is the word of the Lord. We sing hymn 367, Angels from the Realms of Glory.
rise for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel, according to St. Luke, the second chapter.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated for our hymn of the day, 376, Once in Royal David City, 376.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas Eve. Oh, Merry Christmas to you. Our service, our sermon today is going to be taken from our gospel reading in Luke, and the sermon is entitled, Who Gave Himself for You? Christmas is about gifts. There I said it. Right? Usually a pastor doesn't say that, does he? Christmas is not about gifts, is normally what we say. But Christmas is about gifts. Notice the giving language in our readings for today, for this evening, actually. In the Old Testament reading from Isaiah, for to you a child is born, for to you a son is given. In our gospel reading from Luke, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. There is born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. See, this language of gift is in the Scriptures because God is a giver of good gifts. We hear it in our epistle reading from Titus even, right? Our great God and Savior Jesus Christ gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Our great God and our Savior Jesus Christ gave himself for you. And that just doesn't mean speaking about this gift here of the birth and incarnation that we celebrate this day, but it also is the gift of Jesus' death and his resurrection as well. Right? Let's go back to gifts. Right? We like to talk about gifts. Most people exchange gifts on Christmas Day or Christmas Eve or throughout the Christmas season, if I'm correct. Right? Even people from other religions or people who have no particular religious affiliation or even those who do not believe in God or a God, people still like to give gifts. And most people are motivated to give good gifts, right, by people that they like, right? That's what motivates us to give a good gift. Or it could be someone who has really worked hard for us maybe over this year, like a coworker or a boss or a good friend and a good neighbor, right? Such gifts then become actually payment for good behavior, right? For the good work you've done, I'm going to give you a gift, right? So all of this gift giving is dependent on whether you pleased somebody or not. But God is different. God is different. He also gives good gifts to his enemies. He gives good gifts to those who do not believe in him. He gives good gifts to those who do not deserve them. God gives gifts to sinners. Life is one of those gifts. God created ex nihilo, which is Latin for out of nothing. God created out of nothing, and apart from his creation and his goodwill and his love, we would not exist. Our intellect is a gift, whether it is a great intellect or not so great of an intellect. Nonetheless, such as it is a gift from God. The ability to work and earn money for a living, to put daily bread on the table, is a gift from God. Our food and our drink, our house and our home, all of these things are gifts from God. Every family member that you have is a gift from God. Even those who irritate you, even those who disappoint you. Not that any of us here have any of those guys in our family, right? All we are and all we have is a gift from God, a gift out of his divine love, his selflessness, his sacrificial love. Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, God causes, the rain to fall on the just and the unjust alike, and the sun rises on those who believe in Jesus just as well as it does on those who don't believe in Jesus. So God continues to give good gifts. But one of these gifts, his greatest gift, is still given to everyone, to the foolish and the wise, to the rich and to the poor, and to the young and to the old. God gives his son for every sinner. Now, if you're not a sinner, Jesus is not for you. But if you are a sinner, then Jesus is for you. And you get to hear the words that we heard from our gospel reading. You get to take these words to heart. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord for you. The familiar words of the Gospel of St. John. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He gave his only son for you. Not only at the birth, not only at the incarnation, but especially at his death and resurrection, where he has redeemed and made you his and gives you life. God the Father really must love you to send his son as a sacrifice for you. God the Son really must love you to willingly and obediently go to the cross and sacrifice his body and blood for you, a poor, miserable sinner, in order to redeem you, in order to make you his own, in order to bring you into his kingdom and restore you to the love of God. Well, God does love you. He loves you right out there where you're sitting in those pews right now, with all of your sins and with all of your failings and with all of your shortcomings and with all of your ugliness of your life. You are precisely why God sent his son, to be born of a virgin, to suffer under Pontius Pilate. God's word in Romans speaks clearly. God shows us his love, that in while we were still sinners, while we were still ugly with our sin, Christ died for us in your place. It's because of this love of God given to us, right, at this time in particular. Yeah, this is a great time to remember that love, but also it is a great time to remember it all your life. It's what you hold on to. It's what God gives to you as a gift. God gives you his son, a gift that you didn't deserve, a gift that you did not earn, a gift that he gave freely out of his own love. When God loves and forgives in Christ, when that is poured out on you and for you by the power of the Holy Spirit, given to you through the very word and sacraments, through the liturgy and the hymnody, through prayer and biblical study, through the consolation of the body of Christ, through the Christians themselves in the church, then by that same Holy Spirit, Christ becomes the most important thing in the lives of a Christian. God's love and forgiveness in Christ is profound. And it has a profound effect on us. Not only in forgiving us, but also in renewing us, remaking us, that we can put off the old self and live in Christ. St. Paul says in tonight's epistle, right, that the grace of God, right, and we can substitute here, the gift of God that brings all to salvation, also teaches us to deny ourselves ungodliness and worldly lust and to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. We certainly do not live in an age that is characterized by self-denial. Would you say that? Would you say that we live in an age where people are sacrificing for each other all the time? most people don't want to deny themselves anything. That's not merely true of most people. It's also true of our own sinful nature. In spite of all of our ugliness, in spite of all the fact that our flesh and bone and this ugliness sticks to us, in spite of all of this, we still know that selflessness is better than self-centeredness. That sacrificing yourself for the benefit of someone else, and maybe even the ultimate sacrifice, paying the ultimate gift for somebody else's life, is better than loving yourself. Everyone recognizes that this is good, even if you want to deny it. Where does this come from? Where does this selfless, sacrificial love come from? First, it comes from the fact that we were made in the image of God, right? He did not stop loving us when we fell into sin, but gave his only begotten Son to die for our salvation. Everyone knows deep down in their soul, because we are made in the image of God, that this is good. We know that sacrificial love is better than any other form of love, especially self-love. Yet we are mired and marred down in our own sin because we cannot free ourselves. Our own strength cannot make it happen. Apart from his love, his mercy, and his grace given to you in Christ, and received into the lives of broken and contrite sinners, there can be no true love for others. Not like his, which gives of itself even to the point of death. Look at the profound impact God's grace and mercy had on Mary in the story of our Luke's Christmas narrative tonight. When the angel Gabriel announced God's grace to her, "You have found favor with God. You will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." What did Mary do? Receiving God's word and grace, the gift of God's undeserved love come to her, she denied herself and submitted to the loving purpose of this one true God. "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." Even though the angel's message to Mary meant hardship and trouble and suffering and loss of respect with family and friends and neighbors, the Lord's word of promise and grace strengthened her to willingly bear those burdens. Mary was given the strength by God to deny herself because God's profound love for her and all people transformed her. It's by the grace of God that Mary and Joseph, right? Joseph has his own story in the Gospel of Matthew. It's only by God's grace that they received this gift. These poor sinners, that they were even to be enabled to journey to Bethlehem. Only by God's grace was that allowed, to give birth in an animal trough. That's still by God's grace. It was the grace of God that compelled them, even though their path would be filled with suffering and eventually the death of their son on a cross, they were willing to deny themselves the pleasures of this life, the lust of all the things that are around them, the appetite of the flesh, for they have received salvation from him who loved them to the point of death, their own son. The gift of God in Christ is also captured here tonight in the hearts of our shepherds as well. These ordinary, grubby, foul shepherds heard a word that gave them the greatest gift of all: Christ, the Savior of the nations. Christ, the Savior of the world, has come. And when they received that gift, and they were carried along in the strength of that word, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, to Bethlehem to find the babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, just like the angel said, in a manger. And they worshiped. They bowed down and worshiped all the wonderful things God has done, but that is not where they stopped, just in worship. The message of this gift given to them, this message of God's love, was on their lips as they went home, as they walked on the way, as they went back to their cities, as they went back to their villages, proclaiming what they saw and what good news happened to them and all people. This gift is the same gift for you. The Lord comes to you right where you are, with a message of love and forgiveness. He comes to you where you're sitting in the pew with all your sins and your evil lust. He desires you to return, to repent, and receive the forgiveness, and receive the faith that he has given in his Son, Jesus Christ, that you might be poured into, that you might be poured out of, that you might receive forgiveness in life, that you might give forgiveness in life, that you might have eternal life, that you might give eternal life, that you would have the hope of the perfection that is to come on the last day when he returns, and those who have received that gift with you join with you in seeing our one true God and the perfection of that new creation. See, how could you not celebrate God's gift to you? How could you not celebrate the birth of his Son? How could you not confess Jesus Christ on this Christmas tide? As the angels spoke to Mary and to Joseph and to the shepherds, do not be afraid. He also speaks those same words to you. Do not be afraid. I have come for you. I have given you my life. I have given you my salvation. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid of this world. Do not be afraid of anyone else, because I have come for you. See, Christmas is a time of sharing Christ's love. Christ's love for us and for each other. For unto you is born the Christ. Amen.
We rise. We confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God. God entered human history in the person of Jesus, who experienced all our joys and sorrows. He has promised that our Heavenly Father will hear whatever we ask in his name. Let's bring our requests to him in confident faith. Wonderful Counselor, we pray that you will give empathy, wisdom, and compassion to all who seek to meet the needs of the people around them, providing food, clothing, and shelter, tending to the sick and injured, and responding to human crises and natural disasters. Remember, we pray, those with special needs and those known only to you. As you give us opportunity, grant that we may be part of your answers to their petitions. Mighty God, whose word created all things in heaven and on earth, when storms rage, fire spreads, or the earth trembles, give courage and skill to those who would provide rescue, relief, and shelter. Bless those who till the soil and raise crops, and all who manage and distribute the world's bounty, that the hungry be fed, the poor clothed, and the displaced given shelter. Gracious God, receive our plea.
Hear the prayers to you we bring. Father, Spirit, newborn King.
Everlasting Father, shower your grace on all families, enabling parents and children to grow in faith and love. In neighborhoods, communities, and cities where there is discord, open doors of peace. Where there is discrimination, provide justice. Where there is loneliness, provide companionship. Bless individuals and organizations to use the talents and resources you provide to restore dignity, health, and peace to everyone in their care. Gracious God, receive our plea.
Hear the prayers to you we bring, Father, Spirit, newborn King.
Prince of Peace, use the earthly powers that be to put into positions of authority those who will work for justice within their nation in cooperation across their borders. Give protection and courage to police and first responders in their communities and to armed forces deployed. Where wars threaten, move leaders to seek calm. Where long-term animosity gives rise to fear and hatred, open avenues of communication and understanding. Grant that your church stand as a beacon in this troubled world to proclaim the gospel and exhibit loving forgiveness in your name. Grant that many find the peace they seek in you, our gracious Savior. Gracious God, receive our plea. Merciful Father, in this Advent season, we have longed for your Son to come. Today, many of our loved ones long for healing, deliverance, and comfort, especially Lisa, Nancy, Dale. Provide these people with the comfort of your Holy Son. Gracious God, receive our plea.
Hear the prayers to you we bring, Father, Spirit, newborn King.
Into your hands, Heavenly Father, we commend ourselves and all from whom we pray, trusting in your mercy for the sake of him whose birth we celebrate this day, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose birth proclaims the fulfillment of your promises and makes visible your love for us and all people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your name evermore, praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of Sabaoth, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Lord our God, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into time and space as you have promised. He has borne our sin and become our Savior. Gathered in the name of Jesus, we ask, O Lord, that you forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Gather us together with all your saints on the day when we join them at the eternal banquet, which we anticipate in this foretaste of the feast to come. To you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all praise and glory, now and forever. We hear the words of our Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. And we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. We now speak the Agnus Dei. O Christ, thou Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. O Christ, thou Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. O Christ, thou Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Amen. Thank you.
But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. O God, as you make us glad by the yearly festival of the birth of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, grant that we, who joyfully receive him as our Redeemer, may with sure confidence behold him when he comes to be our Judge, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.